Well, hello everybody, it's me again, Dan Scott. And this video, which is long overdue, is going to build off of the knowledge in a previous video I made some time ago called The Then Cosmos. And our understanding of the then world also builds off of our understanding of the two origins. And to get your head around what I'm going to discuss in this video, I recommend you watch both of those videos first, if you haven't already. And in relationship to the two origins and the then cosmos, I want to talk about the origin of darkness, the origin of evil, sin, death, and all that goes along with it. Why does it exist? And who did it originate from, and who did it not originate from? So first, what we need to understand is that such things did not exist within the Father. They did not originate out of the masculine Rosh, or head, of Christ. Nor did these things exist within the Son, who came out of the Father as an origin of an origin, the feminine origin, Reshith. And in relationship to the source and existence of light, of which Jesus Christ is the light of the cosmos, also termed the light carrier, which we'll talk about more later, we know that darkness did not come out of the Father nor the Son, because in 1 John 1:5 it states, God is light, and darkness is not in him. Let me repeat that. Darkness is not in him. And if darkness is not in him, darkness could not come out from him. So in relationship to the source representation of darkness, evil, and all attached to it, it did not exist in the Father or the Son. Where it's also confirmed in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 and 3, that the Son was brought forth out of the Father as the radiance of his glory. And that which is light can only bring forth and form light. Hence, the Father of lights, James 1:17. However, when the former of the light withdraws the light, then becomes present the darkness. So when the former of the light, Isaiah 45:7, withdraws the light, the darkness is created due to the absence of light. And when the maker of peace turns away peace, then evil is created. But this is no indication that darkness nor evil are contained within or in the maker and the creator. In the existence representation, things can exist within or in something, such as the light in the Father and the light in the Son, the radiance of the Father's glory. The same one making the sons of light suitable into a part of the lot of the holy ones in the light, Colossians 1:12. But the existence representation also defines things that exist in due to something. The creating of the darkness was in due to the light carrier withdrawing the light. You see, the darkness doesn't exist because the creator had darkness within himself. That is in his being, because God is light and darkness is not in him. And it's the same with the making of evil. Evil is made when peace is turned away, not because the maker has evil within himself, but evil exists and comes forth due to the turning aside of his peace, the God of the peace, the God who is light. So darkness and evil are not within the creator, but they exist due to or in due to. So, in conjunction with the understanding of the then world, the then cosmos, of course, for those who it is not unnoticed to them that there were a heavens out of old and an earth land out of water, etc., 2 Peter 3:5, hardly anyone would insist that before the creation of the present heavens and earth, that there existed no beings, earthly or heavenly. And what we'll begin to see is that before the creation of the present heavens and earth, both good and evil carried over from that then cosmos, represented in the tree being the personified tree of the knowledge of both good and evil. And although the evil carried over, what God had made according to the new creation of the present heavens and earth was exceedingly good. because every good giving and every accordingly accomplished gifting is from above, descending from the Father of lights, James 1:17. So the point being is that evil in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was not something created as brand new to the present heavens and earth, but it existed before in the then cosmos. So now let's begin to talk about Mr. Death. Who is Mr. Death? The originator of evil, darkness, and the faliance. What are the circumstances which brought forth darkness and evil in the then cosmos, carrying over into the present cosmos, which will be made down on working in the impending cosmos? Well, this is in relationship to the one termed Melech Zor, the regent, the king of rock, Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 12. And on the screen, I'm going to place verses 12 through 19, where here the Hebrew word melach defines a king, a regent, of which regents and kings include heavenly beings, or malachim, of which angelic malachim are arch beings, from the Greek arche, origin beings, Ephesians 6:12 and Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. And where these beings have various rankings and classes, some of these beings did pursue the dark in the then cosmos and the present, but some did not. And what we'll begin to see is that prior to the fall of Melech Zor, there was no darkness to be pursued. And here Melech Zor is identified as a cherub. And as I will begin to explain in more detail, this cherub was and is not Satan, and neither is Melech Zor the same one of Isaiah chapter 14 verse 12 termed Helel, which we'll also talk about. So first, who is this cherub Melech Zor? Well, the answer may be very shocking to you, so I hope you're sitting down. Because Melech Zor, the one described as full of wisdom and a complete one of beauty, immaculate, verse 15, is a son of the only become Son of God, Jesus Christ. And where Jesus Christ is the anointed one, this one is described as a circumanointed one, yea, the overhutting one, and I gave you to be on the Mount of Holiness, where the I here is not speaking of the Father, the head of Christ, but Jesus as Yahweh, termed the only become God, John chapter 1, verses 14 and 18. But where Jesus Christ as Son came forth as the only become from beside the Father, the only become God, Melech Zor, he became found as a God, an Elohim. Verse 14, as the same immaculate one of verse 15, where he walked in the midst of the stones of fire. And just as I talk about in my video Two Origins, where we see the Father as masculine origin libated the Son as an origin, well, the only become God, Jesus Christ, on the Mount of Holiness, also created this one as the circumanointed one termed Melech Zor, the regent of rock, the son of the rock, Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. So simply, we could say that Melech Zor is a grandson, a second generation libation, of whom the Son of God, Jesus Christ, libated, created. And this grandson was empowered to the highest degree under the headship of his Father, the Logos God, Jesus Christ, John 1:1. And in the feminine origin, where Jesus Christ as Son shared in the light union towards his Father, the God of John 1:2, Melech Zor wanted to become independent from his head, Jesus Christ. And part of this was due to the high vaulting of Melech Zor's heart according to his own beauty, a light being among origin beings, where Yahweh granted this son his desire to be independent from his head, resulting in the dissolving of the light union between himself and his son, Melech Zor. And this was the making a way to the dark, to the anti, the instead of the light, hence the dark, which, as I stated, now became something that could be pursued, among those who will the same, who choose to not have union with the light, hence sons of the darkness. And not only was Melech Zor dissolved or cast away from the light, his head, Jesus Christ, the light of the cosmos, the then cosmos, but he was removed away from the stones of fire. Other light beings, where fire is often a figure of speech describing angels in a flame of fire. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, where we also see the making of the spirits to his angels and the flames of fire to his officiators in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 7. So these stones here are light beings. So when the overhutting cherub was cast away from the midst of the stones of fire, the now independent one, Melech Zor, no longer had access to the light of his original head, or the light beings that surrounded him as his behutting. And therein lied the diminishing of the light and the creation of a way of darkness, the way to the anti, the instead of, the replacement of the light. And although darkness and evil did not exist within the Father or the Son, understand that this iniquity that originated through Melech Zor could only come about through the given possibility, when this one's independence was granted by his own Father, the Son of God, Jesus Christ. And when the self-elevation of Melech Zor took place, the intention to establish the possible independence in the realm of the Logos God, the light, Melech Zor's desire was granted to him. And as I briefly mentioned, according to John 1:2, Melech Zor himself is no longer towards his head the Logos God, the Word. As I explained in my video Two Origins, there are two gods being represented in verse 1. In the origin was the Word, the Logos, and the Word, the Logos God, was toward the God, speaking of his Father, his head, the head of Christ, 1 Corinthians 11:3. But also the Word, the Logos, was God, that is, in the capacity of verses 14 and 18. The Father is God, but the Son is also God, as the only become God. Just as Melech Zor himself was created as a god, surrounded by gods, where these in Ezekiel 28:13 exist in the garden of the gods, the mountain of gods, verse 16. In that, the Pharisees and scribes could not get their head around the concept of Jesus Christ as God, is seen in John chapter 10, where he says, "Is it not written in your law, I say you are gods?" Where Jesus is quoting from Psalms 82 in the context of fallen gods, fallen sons of God, where our expectation is also to become sons of God according to the resurrection as sons of God equal to angels in a flame of fire, a figure of speech for the light beings that angels and these beings are, stones, stones of fire, under the headship of the living stone, as ourselves living stones. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. So let me reiterate that this arc origin of the darkness came into existence as light, as a light being, sharing in the unity of the light with his Father, Jesus Christ, the light of the cosmos, until iniquity was found in this one. And we see that Jesus Christ, the Logos God, the only become God, below origin beginning in the shape of God, the Father, did not count to be equal with God as a robbing. Philippians chapter 2, verse 6, where Melech Zor did. So in the creating of Melech Zor, Ezekiel chapter 28:15, he was created as the cherub, not as an only become son from beside the Father, or only become God, John 1:18, but as the Son of the Son, the circumanointed one, where we read, he became found in Eden, the garden of Elohim, the garden of the gods in heaven, not on earth, but in heaven, not to be confused with the Eden of the earth land, in which the tree being of the living ones and the tree being of the knowledge of good and evil were found, again, according to the present cosmos in heavens and earth. which this darkness and evil carried over. So when Melech Zor was cast out of heaven, he was cast out of the Mount of Elohim, the Mount of the gods, the stones, where his father gave him up as lost, away from the midst of the stones of fire, his body, where this list of names in verse 13 identifies or encompasses their rankings according to their value. Simply stated, these names identify these various beings. And I might add that the sons of God mentioned in Job chapter 38, verse 7, this too has its context in the then cosmos. And it was in the then cosmos where we read, "You corrupted your wisdom on account of your radiation when he shared in the light union with his father, as himself an angelic cherub radiating light." Where we also considered Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 and 3, and the radiance of the Son's glory when he came out from the Father. And when Melech Zor was towards his head, he was immaculate in his ways from the day he was created. And that is until he failed and then was desecrated away from the mountain of the gods. Now, next, pay attention carefully, because when he was given as ashes on the earthland, it was before the eyes of all those on the earthland seeing this one being cast out of heaven, which context is not according to the now present heavens and earth, but the one out of old, where the peoples of verse 19, the human beings that existed in the then cosmos, were shot, causing confusing frights. So in the origin, Melech Zor was brought forth as a light being, out of the true light, his father, Jesus Christ. And the authority of the father of Melech Zor to dissolve the light union was granted to him, providing a way to the dark, to the antithesis of the light, among both heavenly beings and earthly beings, which again did not have to be pursued, but it became something that could be pursued and was pursued even in the then cosmos, because the result of the increase of lawlessness and the faillance is what we read in Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, when the light was withdrawn, just as it will be again in the coming transition. So next, how does Satan fit into the picture here? What is the relationship of Satan to Melech Zor? Well, simply stated, Satan is a created son of Melech Zor, who was also created in the then cosmos as a light being prior to the fall of Melech Zor, the same one termed Helel here in Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12, identifying him as the Illuminator, where here Isaiah is accounting for the fall of Satan, where the antithesis, the instead of to Jesus Christ as the son of the human, is Helel, the son of the whole away loosening, where in the transitional testifying time will manifest in the instead laying one, the son of the whole away loosening outlined in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the human of lawlessness. And as I talked about in my previous video, down establish, when Jesus Christ, the son of the human, comes in his parousia and will be present on the earthland, so will this one be present on the earthland, in antithesis as the son of the whole away loosening. And this is what we're seeing in this account in Isaiah chapter 14. According to the present heavens and earth, not the then cosmos, but the now cosmos. And in the transition from the present to the new heavens and earth, Jesus Christ, the light carrier, will be unveiled, as will his body, the outcalled, the light carriers. But so will be unveiled the lawless one, termed Helel, the Illuminator, when he comes in the person of the human of lawlessness, when also the sons of the dark and the sons of the night will be unveiled as well. And it will be the battle of regents, Luke 14:31. Regency against regency, Luke 21:10. It will be the strong one against the stronger one, Luke 11:21 and 22. So again, in that then cosmos, prior to the fall of Melech Zor, Satan shared in the light union with his father, his head, Melech Zor, and Melech Zor with his head, Jesus Christ. And then, of course, they all shared in the light unity with the Father, among all of the sons of God, the stones, the sons of light. Job 38:7, in the light calling unitedly of the stars of the morning, and when all the sons of Elohim jubilated. And where Melech Zor was given as ashes on the earth land before the eyes of all those seeing him, this is not what we see with Helel. No, this one is said to be honed down to the earth land as stretching down over nations. And the statement, "Oh, how you have fallen out of the heavens," is not a desecrating away from the mount of the Elohim, the mount of the gods, as being given up as lost, again in conjunction with his father being given as ashes on the earth land, where this one again is said to be stretching down over nations as falling out of heaven. So what we're seeing thus far is the account of Melech Zor is looking backwards into the then cosmos, where this has its context prophetically according to the now present cosmos. And the word hone here is from the Hebrew gada. And a honing of something is not the same as casting down of something. A honing is a shortening. A casting down is what we see in Genesis 1:2, spoken of as the downcast of the cosmos in many New Testament verses, which I discuss in my video, The Then World. And concerning the account of Melech Zor's casting to the earth as ashes, in the biblical accounts of the time after the creation of the present heavens and earth land, there is no event regarding the fall of a star or an angel, which was witnessed by those on the earth land that came burning and had turned into ashes. However, in this now present eon, we will, because like father, like son, Luke chapter 10, verse 18, where Satan falling as lightning is in the aorist tense, not the past tense. This is an event that has yet to occur. It's a prophetic pre-explanation concerning the sign of Satan in antithesis to the sign of the son of the human as lightning. And in comparison to Melech Zor being cast out of heaven into the earth land as given up as ashes in the witness of all the peoples, here we read that though seeing you, to you they gaze, to you they differentiate, meaning they understand that Helel the Illuminator is the one making quake the earth land, the one shaking regent domes, which is not what we see with the peoples concerning Melech Zor's fall. And according to the present cosmos, Isaiah chapter 14, verse 13 points to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4. So what we can perceive, according to the account of Melech Zor, is that it reveals the existence of a mankind in the previous heavens and earth, the former eon, the former cosmos, who witnessed the father of Satan, Melech Zor, being cast down to the earth as ashes, where in the coming shaking of the heavens and earth of present, the human of this eon, the Illuminati, will witness their father, the Illuminator, as the one making the land of confusion. And at present, Satan himself is not cast out of heaven as ashes, but he is the god of this eon, stretching down over nations. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. But again, Satan will make his appearance in the man of lawlessness, the instead laying one and the being made arrogant one unto all that is say or called God or honored, so that he coming into the temple of God takes his seat there, showing himself, demonstrating himself as God, whom the Lord Jesus will consume with the spirit of his mouth and make down unworking in the on appearing of his own parousia, which will be at the altogether finishing of the eon. So again, like father, like son, where the result of the father Melech Zor is seen in Genesis 1:2, a parallel to the present darkening that will come is seen in verses such as Isaiah chapter 13, verse 10, Matthew 24, 29, and others. And all of this can be seen in light of what we read here in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 9, which reads, "What is it that which has become? It is that which will become. And what is it that which has been made? It is that which will be made. And there is nothing wholly new under the sun." Where verse 10 is pointing right back to the then cosmos, where it states, "Is there a thing of which one speaks? See this, it is new. It has already become towards the eons, that is, towards the now present eon and the impending eon, hence eons, which previous eon became away from our face. Where we have to understand that some of the statements in the prophetic writings look back into that then cosmos, such as Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 12 through 19, and Job chapter 38, verse 7. Where in Ecclesiastes 1:11 it states, there is no sign of remembrance to the origin beings, and even to the latter ones, the descendants of such, which will become, speaking of fallen angels according to the present cosmos, such as accounted for in Enoch, which Book of Enoch has been all but ignored and rejected, which should not be a surprise because we just read the prophecy concerning such concealment. However, for those of us diligently seeking the word of truth, God opens up our understanding. So, Helel, as the Illuminator, presently is active in the earthland as the accuser, the adversary, Diabolos. And the ones who want to insist that Melech Zor is Helel, they are one and the same, would also have to be of the opinion that God, after casting Melech Zor down, reinstated him as Diabolos, the accuser, the adversary, who at present is walking about as a growling lion seeking somebody to down drink, 1 Peter 5:8. And furthermore, such an opinion that Melech Zor is Satan would contradict the statement, and you were not there anymore, where on the contrary, Helel is stretching down over nations. And before I finish this video, let's talk about this word Helel, which occurs one time here in Isaiah 14:12. As I've said, Helel designates this one as the Illuminator, erroneously translated Lucifer, O Son of the Morning, and even some translations add the word star, morning star. But this one-time Hebrew word Helel here, which is a noun, is derived from a verb occurring about 165 times in the Old Testament, which is halal, H-A-L-A-L, Strong's number H-1984, where this verb halal defines something that shines. And yes, stars shine, but the Hebrew word kohav, defining a star or stars, is not even in this verse. And where the DLT translates halal as the son of the black redness, this is because the Hebrew word is shachar. However, the word morning is from the Hebrew word boker, morning, which also does not occur in this verse. So Helel here, the Illuminator, is defined as a sun, which in Hebrew is bane, which then is followed by the noun shachar, which is the dawn, the early red dawn, and should be distinguished from morning because it's a different word. Where we see here in Genesis chapter 19, verse 15, as the black redness ascended, Shechar, where the two angels, the commissioners here, are causing Lot to speed up, to get it in gear, demonstrating urgency to take his wife, his Menes, and his two daughters. Not only to get the heck out of Dodge, but don't look back. All a type and shadow and a parallel to what is yet impending in relationship to the fall of Helel, the son of the black redness, not the morning star, but the illuminator. And while we're at it, let's address this verse in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, because the translators have also mishandled these words. And what Peter's confirming here is the witness on the mount when Jesus was transshaped in front of them, when he radiated light. The word translated radiates through is diagazo from dia, which is the Greek preposition denoting that which is through something, and agazo, literally to shine, not dawn. And honestly, this word family has nothing to do with the dawn, where in Greek there is no word defining dawn. And the reason you see it included in these definitions at Bible Hub and Blue Letter Bible is because they're biased towards the King James translations, which translates this word dawn. This is simply irresponsible translating. And what we find in relationship to morning in the New Testament is from the Greek word boker, which should never be translated dawn, but morning. And the word boker is not even in the text of this verse. And because diagazo is in the same word family as what we see in Hebrews 1:3, it would be ridiculous to translate this word in Hebrews 1:3 as morning or even dawn, who being the dawn or the morning of his glory, which would make the word of God meaningless, of which these translations do just that. And these errors are not isolated cases here. I could point out thousands of them. And when we use a pattern of words being healthy, we can find the deepest context of the profound truth here according to the day radiating, which points to Psalms chapter 2, verse 7, where we see that the Father brought forth the Son. He born him as the day. Not a 24-hour day, but the being called the day, of which we who are in Christ are sons of the day. 1 Thessalonians 5:5. So you see the folly in not using a pattern of words being healthy. But we're not finished, because there's more folly here. Because Jesus is also identified here as the light carrier, often translated and understood as morning star. So again, the word morning is from the Greek bocher, which again is not in this text. The word star is from the Greek word aster, also not in the text. So you have to ask yourself, what in the world is going on with these translations? And how can people such as these King James activists defend them? And what were these translators doing? Well, I can tell you what they were not doing was guarding the word of truth. So here the word light carrier is from the Greek adjective phosphorus, not bocher and not aster, where this word occurs only this one time in the entire New Testament. Properly translated light carrier. And the reason the adjective is translated light carrier is because it is derived from the noun phos, defining light, as well as the verb phero, to carry. So the adjective phosphorus modifying the noun is properly rendered light carrier, of whom we in Christ are light guardians in the cosmos. Philippians 2:15, sons of the light. Again, 1 Thessalonians 5:5. So why is it important to use a pattern of words being healthy? Well, first of all, it answers the question which is proposed on the screen here, found at gotquestions.org, in relationship to these verses of Isaiah 14:12 and 2 Peter 1:19 here, as well as other verses I won't even get into in this video. Which I might add, the answers that are given at this website are also full of error, and they don't address the faulty Bible translations whatsoever. So their answers are based on faulty understanding and lack of deeper investigating into the writ, where the unknowledge concerning such answers involves the understanding of everything I'm discussing here concerning Melech Zor and his son, the Illuminator, and their relationship to the Son of God and the Father. Where also you see in the answers to these questions, they always point into the book of Revelation, which book is a large part of the method of the error, Ephesians 4:14. And understanding correctly shows us that Jesus Christ is not a morning star, but neither is Satan. Jesus Christ is the light carrier in the context of the day that radiates through. Helel is the illuminator in accord with the black redness, the darkest hour of the red dawn. So not only is Jesus the light carrier, he's the light of the cosmos, John chapter 8, verse 12. The light of human, John 1, 4. The true light which enlightens all and every human coming into the cosmos, John 1, 9. Everything that encompasses the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father is light, not darkness. Where obviously Helel, the illuminator, is the false light, the one who after schematizes himself as an angel of light, the light that is darkness, where Jesus stated, if your eye, singular eye, is evil, hence the all-seeing Illuminati eye, your whole body will be dark. Hence, if the light in you is darkness, how manifold then is the darkness? Matthew 6:23. And if you're paying attention, the time has come for things to start becoming unveiled, where many are rambling on about the so-called Illuminati, where the tentacles of the Illuminati, of which origins we're discussing in this video, with its source in Melech Zor carrying over into the present in Helel, the Illuminator, these tentacles are stretching out into the entertainment world, sports, music, Hollywood, art, fashion. But not only that, the media, the entire economic system, the Federal Reserve Bank, which is run by those termed the Zionists, the Freemasons, and much, much more, whose god is Helel, the Illuminator, according to their designation as the Illuminati. So now we have a much wider perspective regarding all of these things. So, as to the origins of darkness and evil and unrighteousness, rebellion and death, such things did not exist in the Father or the Son. As James wrote, "Be not errorized, my beloved brothers. Every good giving and every accordingly accomplished gifting is from above, descending from the Father of the lights, with whom there is no change or manner of shadowing." Meaning there is no contrasting light and dark, but only light. Had there been any iniquity in the Son coming out of the Father, it would also have been in the Father. But God is light, and darkness is not in him, yea, not one. 1 John 1:5. And again, when Melech Zor came out from his head, where Jesus Christ was toward his Father, they shared in the unity of the light, when unitedly all of the sons of God jubilated. Job 38:7. And prior to the fall of Melech Zor, Helel belonged to this unified jubilation as the Illuminator, a shining one, just as his Father was radiating light, Ezekiel 28:17. So the point being again is that God is light. The Father of the lights speaks to the radiating light of angelic beings, of which Melech Zor was created as a light being on the Mount of Elohim, the Mount of the Gods, where his heart became high vaulted in due to his beauty, and he corrupted his wisdom on account of his radiation. And due to his transgression, his Father dissolved the light unity, and subsequently Melech Zor's son, Helel, was honed down to the earthland as the one presently stretching down over the nations. So I hope it's comforting that you understand and know that darkness and evil were not within the Father or the Son. However, they exist in due to the authority and power of the light of the cosmos, Jesus Christ, to make or to create them by dissolving the light, by turning away peace, originating in the granting of the will of Melech Zor, who was the first son of the darkness, making a way into the dark, the antithesis of the light. And this is the love of the promise which we have heard from him and re-announced to you, that God is light and dark is not in him, yea, not one.